Tonight I'll be speaking about how globalization of art market had sort of like gave a rise to more nationalistic art, and it turned out to be marginalizing Asian American artists by looking at Yayoi Kusama's case. I've done pretty extensive research at Kusama's studio and everything. So after the talk, I would like to take questions, and if you have some things in particular, we can perhaps like discuss about it. I brought my book. If you are interested, please buy purchase. It's going to be $25 copy. And tonight's talk is from the book's chapter 3. The chapter 1 is about the rise of totalitarian society in Japan, and I have done some research about Kusama's tendency of repainting some of the old works. So it's very much looking at the actual art, and also how she has been influenced by totalitarian society. The second chapter is more philosophical. It looks at some of the post-World War II tendencies, and especially about the issues of ethics. I have compared and contrasted Japan and Italy and Germany, which were Axis Alliance countries, and they come from very similar circumstances. And then the third chapter is about art market, and then fourth chapter is about psychedelic movement. It's actually tonight's talk combines the third and fourth chapter. The oldest international contemporary art exhibition, the Venice Biennale, has been described as the Olympics of art. The world's leading nations compete for awards that can shape contemporary cultural hegemonies. In 1964, after Robert Rauschenberg won the US first grand prize for painting, suddenly a roster of white male art stars, all belonging to a single gallery, Leo Castelli, came to define American art. And as you can see, that only woman who is in this picture is Roy Lichtenstein's wife, and here is Leo Castelli, Joseph Kosuth, Lawrence Winner, Frank Stella, Rauschenberg, Dan Rabin. As you can see, that there's Richard Serra. It's a very, very male world. Okay. So, and it belonged to a single gallery. I think that's the point. And the prices of his artists' work skyrocketed. Jasper Johns' flag, for instance, having sold for $600 in 1958, went for $600,000 in 1970. At the 1966 biennial, the New York-based Japanese artist Yayoi Kusama collaborated with the Italian dealer to present Narcissus' Garden, 1,500 mechanically produced mirrored orbs on two lawns in front of the Italian pavilion. And people tend to think that she didn't have a permission, but she actually did have a permission through Italian dealer, so that's why she's showing in front of Italian pavilion here. And she was very prepared. She went to see this site in January 1966, and this is in June 1966. Okay, her presence signaled a countervailing phenomenon of the 60s, that of transnationalization. In her Narcissus Garden statement, challenging aspects of the new establishment, Kusama wrote, quote, "Today's art has become exceedingly expensive, detached from the mass," unquote. And she priced her balls at only $2 a piece. it's here. Okay. In Narcissus Garden, a site-specific installation and performance work, Kusama flaunted her gender and ethnicity by wearing a girlish dress here, red leotard, and a silver kimono. Thus, she foreshadowed certain initiatives of the 70s feminist art movement in its quest for what Anna Chave, who was my advisor at the CUNY Graduate Center, called an authentically different art marked by woman's experience. To illuminate how her art was distinct from that of her male counterparts, in this talk I will compare Kusama's development through 1969 to the more canonized work of her US male peers. Born in 1929 to an affluent family, Kusama grew up under a totalitarian regime. She took up painting a non-conformist pursuit at the age of 13. After World War II, as the US-led allies took control in Japan, its cultural orientation shifted away from Europe to the United States. And this is the US information strategy that the government had used media services in order to control the entire world, as you can see. And it includes Voice of America and other things, but art was also very important, and they had more grassroots exchange between art teachers with American art practitioners and so on. So there was a very conscious shift which took place during this time. Okay. And Kusama moved to New York. As a consequence of these changes, Kusama moved to New York in 1958 and was assimilated into the downtown scene, where an array of post-war emigres launched their career through the 8th Street Club and the 10th Street Cooperative Galleries. Her initial contribution to this scene was five large white paintings exhibited in October 1959. Donald Judd, reviewing for Art News, assessed them as some of the best paintings around and bought two works. The young Frank Stella bought another, and Kusama began drawing increasing attention from her peers. Other regulars at the 8th Street Club included Leo and Ileana Castelli, a Jewish couple who fled Nazi-occupied France, arriving in Manhattan in 1941. And this is their immigration record. Their last name was Kraus Castelli at this particular moment, and this is Leo, Ileana, and their daughter, Julia. Born Leo Kraus in 1907 in Austro-Hungarian Trieste, Castelli eventually enlisted in the US military, returning to Europe in 1945. There he learned that his parents had perished in the war. After his discharge, Castelli began dealing art privately and joined the club. Ileana remembered that the, quote, mental and emotional climate of these gatherings was somewhat chauvinistic, unquote, but disillusioned with Europe, the couple preferred U.S. art, and Leo especially would favor U.S.-born artists when they opened their gallery in 1957. And as you can see, that he is very much aligning with the American flag by Jasper Johns here. So the gallery itself very much looking like he's representing American art. So his ambition can be deduced from this first official portrait of himself as a gallerist taken at Johns' successful solo exhibition in 1958. Standing next to flag, Castelli cunningly identified his gallery with an American icon. Some of Castelli's intimates have noted that he was less a first-rate connoisseur than a consummate strategist. Using the third person, Castelli once explained that, quote, it's not only his eye that dictates, he doesn't want to be biased, unquote. In many ways, The vision of new American art promoted by Castelli and his powerful network of dealers was shaped by profound anti-European feelings resulting from the collective trauma of the Second World War. Like a general mapping out a campaign, explained fellow gallerist Robert Elkon, Castelli arranged with other dealers so his artists would gain visibility all over the world. Quote, "We are all on his side," unquote, proclaimed another Confederate, Joseph Hellman. If you don't like Leo's vision, of course, you find that it's all corrupt. Four of John's works that Castelli sold to MoMA attracted phenomenal attention in 1958. Already in 1960, the Martha Jackson Gallery attempted to historicize this neo-Dada trend with a new forms, new media exhibition. A genealogical survey of 75 artists, all somewhat bound to Dada. In the catalog, British pop art pundit Lawrence Alloway encouraged the emergent embrace of commonplace objects, which he explained differed decisively from the cultural insurgency of historical Dada. Jackson's show attracted massive media attention. Subsequently, many New York artists included Andy Warhol. Kusama's development after the net paintings evidenced a subtle resistance to the simple embrace of banal objects. Between 1960 and 1961, while Warhol painted blown-up images taken from newspaper and other sources, Kusama made papier-collé by repetitively pasting photographs and mass-produced labels in irregular patterns to support Judd, her neighbor, between 1961 and 64, later attested that Warhol likely saw her work at Stephen Radich Gallery in October 1961. That December, he began producing his first multiple Campbell soup can images, forging for himself the identity of a machine-like artist. On close scrutiny, however, Warhol carefully conceives his design and often hand-painted his work. And of course, his January 1962 Campbell soup cans were all hand-painted. What I refer to here are his later works, that he was an extremely detail-oriented artist, and the idea of using repetition he may have gotten from Kusama. By contrast, after her December 1961 encounter with Freudian psychiatrist Yasuhiko Taketomo, Kusama probed deeply into her psyche for feeling that Freud labeled uncanny. In her 1962 accumulation series, she covered the surface of households and other commonplace objects with some fabric protuberances. Curator Linda Levansky described them disturbing and parodic, while Mignon Nixon observed how in these parodies the phallus might be undermined as a patriarchal symbol, and here she's trying to cut these phallic sculptures with knife and fork. In June 1962, Kusama premiered her soft sculpture, it's here, alongside work by such future Castelli artists as Oldenburg, Robert Morris, and then James Rosenquist, and Warhol. Here is his dollar bill painting. So they all launched the career together at this place called Green Gallery. And in terms of Asian Americans, the director of Green Gallery, who sort of like defined New York movement of the 60s, was a Chinese American person. Okay. And the prominent vanguard, this was a prominent vanguard venue. her amassed knobs bearing a resemblance to mutilated male genitalia evoked feelings of eerie discomfort. Oldenburg, who only now admits the possibility that he was influenced by Kusama, immediately after the show delegated his wife to sew his work. 3 months later, he premiered his sewn sculptures in a solo exhibition, winning international acclaim. Judd remembered that Kusama was irritated by Warhol, but her shock at seeing Oldenburg's sewn sculptures was immeasurable. She became, quote, very paranoid about the New York art situation. Another artist's neighbor, Ed Clark, testified that she grew obsessed with the thought that her ideas might be appropriated and closed all the curtains in her loft. This was most probably for the photo shooting session that she closed this room, but this is her loft, and it's at the corner of 19th Street and Park Avenue, but she tends to be in the central part. This was her studio back then. Okay. And she closed all the curtains and in her loft. 11 days after Oldenburg's opening, Kusama was likely suffering from anxiety neurosis and took Doriden, a prescription minor tranquilizer, as noted in her calendar diary. So this was Oldenburg's opening here, and this is the first log of Doriden, which she was taking, and this was a minor tranquilizer. Okay. 2 months later, when Oldenburg's exhibition review began appearing in such influential art magazines as Art Studio International, Kunstwerk, Art News, and Art International, with large reproductions of his soft sculptures, Kusama's neurosis was aggravated and she was hospitalized at St. Luke's Hospital. This was her first stay in the psychiatric department. After being discharged, she required almost weekly psychiatric counseling. She also had to take tranquilizers and was thus sedated for most of 1963. That year, she compensated for her decreased productivity by adopting more mechanical processes. In December 1963, she finally held a solo exhibition of her sewn sculptures in New York, Aggregation 1000 Boat Show, which featured a boat she had realized the year before and an image of its photograph reproduced 999 times. I think it may be lesser, but it's a metaphor. Okay. A technique that reappeared in 1966 in Warhol's car wallpaper. In October 1966, 11 months after Kusama revealed her first mirror-lined environment, which was called Floor Show in November 1965, at the little-known Richard Castellan Gallery, Lucas Samaras, who would in 1976 list Kusama among his formative influences, introduced his mirror room at the renowned Pace Gallery, and Kusama again suffered an attack of neurosis. There is no doubt that with post-war internationalization of art, the New York-based artist could agree that Kusama was an influential artist, but the 60s art world was male-dominated. Quote, a world where both men and women are trying to please men in power, unquote, recalled Louis Bourgeois. The best slots in first-rate contemporary galleries were generally reserved for young male artists. By the time Kusama's 1963 boat show, Oldenburg and Warhol had established themselves with their respective 1962 solo exhibitions, and Sidney Janis's 1963 New Realist show further celebrated these artists, Kusama observed those galleries representing pop art are very nationalistic and exclusive, unquote. And indeed, at the 1964 Venice Biennial, Castelli prompted U.S. exponents of what Janis termed New Realism as architects of the new American art. An opportunity for Castelli to establish his reputation globally came when MoMA stopped backing the Venice Biennial in 1962. That year, the government for the first time took over sponsoring the biennial and appointed Jewish Museum Director Alan Solomon, one of Castelli's clients, as the commissioner for the U.S. Pavilion. The biennial in 1964 was especially notorious. Solomon proclaimed in the official catalog that, quote, the world's center of art had moved from Paris to New York. U.S., unquote, U.S. artists were presented at two different spaces, the official pavilion and the former U.S. consulate. When Rauschenberg's prize was almost jeopardized for his not having enough work at the official site, early one morning, three large combines here were relocated to the U.S. pavilion. The scene was documented by a photographer friend of Castelli's and promptly offered to the media. Once the award was announced, the Italian press denounced U.S. art as despiritualized and devoid of all human values. But the brouhaha ultimately contributed to U.S. art's global commercial viability. In the 70s, for example, 10% of Leo Castelli's gallery sales were made in New York, 50% in other U.S. domestic markets, and 40% in Europe. By paying Castelli a 20% sales margin, galleries could receive packaged exhibitions of U.S. artists. Protesting the conspicuous commodification of art, artist Elaine Sturtevant in 1965 created an imaginary art department store filled with reproductions of artwork sold at Castelli. When the Green Gallery closed in 1965, Castelli took on many of Kusama's peers, and she recorded her in her notebook her acute pain at being left farther behind. As the art world became increasingly professionalized and rationalized and business-minded, she instructed herself, quote, never call Donald Judd and never go to Oldenburg's studio, unquote. Her struggle developed in significant part from the fact that she was a Japanese woman in an art world that mainly privileged Anglo-American males. But because of this difficulty, Kusama was able to develop her art in unique ways. It was during this time that she affirmed the first five principles. One, carry out my original intention. Two, have foresight. Three, never monumentalize. Four, never compromise. And five, be ambitious. When strategizing her contribution to events in Venice in 1966, Kusama thought that rather than holding the Narcissus Garden show at the third-class gallery, it was more effective to exhibit at an unconventional venue to attract public attention, critical like Sturtevant of the increasing commodification of art. She also protested against the recent shift in the cultural politics of pop. As the movement had begun to prevail in the global art market, however, the prices of pop art started to rise. Thus, Kusama spiritedly commented on her male counterpart's lack of balls by suggesting that she would carry on her own pop struggle for the genuine democratization of art by selling her work for $2 each. Competing with Warhol's factory, she had her balls fabricated at the real factory. After Narcissus Garden, Kusama's father thought of new audience and came up with an idea of her first psychedelic art entitled Love Forever, a plan she submitted for the exhibition called Zero on Sea, which was the world's pioneering transnational site-specific art project intended to offer direct social engagement, scheduled to open in April 1966 at Scheveningen Pier, the Netherlands. And what you're looking at are the plan, and there is Gutai artist Motonaga Sadamasa, I think, and then Eve Klein's Fire Fountains, and she was going to have her mirrored environment within this context. Although in the end, Zero on Sea did not happen due to its increasing cost, Kusama's psychedelic art was intended for people from all walks of life with an intention for social change. Initially characterized as art that has been significantly influenced by psychedelic experience induced by mind-expanding psychoactive drugs such as mescaline, psilocybin, and LSD. Psychedelic art is today said to be characterized by artist experimental and dissenting politics. For Kusama to come up with the idea for Love Forever, Timothy Leary's first public lecture on consciousness expanding drugs that took place at Cooper Union in New York in December 1964, and his August 1965 demonstration of psychedelic light show were an immense influence, with his sound and light show an amalgam of sound, flashing light, and images reflected on the mirror walls. Leary offered transformative experience similar to the influence of active hallucinogens to the viewers. Already that fall, Kusama logged in her notebook, quote, "I am preparing an electric sculpture for Holland," unquote. This would become her first psychedelic art. She would later introduce herself as the high priestess of her movement, echoing Leary's high priest of his pseudo-religious movement, the League for Spiritual Discovery, in short, LSD. With the cancellation of Zero on Sea, Kusama built a similar work to Love Forever entitled Peep Show at Castellane Gallery in New York. This mirror-lined hexagonal room with the blue, red, white, and yellow light bulbs on the ceiling here, flashing on and off several times per second while Beatles music played for the show's duration, was meant to induce synesthetic effect, and mirrors were an important guide to the psychedelic experience. One goal of psychedelic art was to alter the spectator's normal perception. According to Leary, our surroundings make imprints on the human brain, thus reinventing the environment can produce different levels of consciousness, stages of imprinting information, and psychogeometry, which can modify human behavior. Peep Show was a closed space, but Kusama originally planned it as letting people come inside of Love Forever and walk around. By June 1967, she would develop Peep Show into her first psychedelic happening, which was called Self-Obliteration. Adopting Leary's sound and light show, which she called an audio-visual light performance, Kusama's light show was an interactive venture with an amalgam of sound and light in a dark space. This is her first psychedelic light performance. She wanted to first liberate people from their conventional thinking, then invited invited participants to paint polka dots on each other. As she explained in 1968, polka dot can not to stay alone like the communicative life of people. Two and three and more polka dots become movement. By 1967, Kusama would develop her light show into what she called naked happenings, with which she attempted to change people's essential opinions about sexuality from their conventional view. In November 1967, Kusama premiered her first public naked happening in Delft in the Netherlands. And this is how much people's perception had changed. With naked happening, Kusama celebrated eros or life force. According to the main theorist of the New Left movement, Herbert Marcuse, people were generally miserable since they were efficiently manipulated and organized by the dehumanizing condition of profitable affluence called capitalism, a system that values labor over pleasure. If the human body can become an instrument of pleasure, then Marcuse believed that people would become more satisfied and the world could become a better place. Transforming the Freudian death drive into a life drive, many New Left supporters during the Vietnam War wanted to fight for eros against death, and with her psychedelic happenings, Kusama competed with Warhol. The artist who she designated as her arch rival, and this is Warhol's psychedelic extravaganza. 1 month after Kusama's peep show in April 1966, Warhol and his entourage began presenting their psychedelic happenings called Exploding Plastic Inevitable, in short EPI, at an enormous second floor dance hall in the National Polish Home, known also as the Dome, in East Village, New York. Unlike Kusama's group that advocated dreamy hallucinogens like LSD, Warhol's followers were famous for their abuse of amphetamines and methamphetamines that made people aggressive and restless. On the stage, Warhol and the EPI revealed a sadomasochistic spectacle. Warhol's right-hand man, Gerald Malanga, dressed his principal partner, Mary Woronoff, in a skin-tight black costume, taught her the routine, handed her a whip, and transformed her into a beautiful dominatrix. Although Woronoff viewed herself as having occupied a dominant position, a recent study reveals that after using amphetamines, people had their sexual abnormalities, including a penchant for sadomasochistic behavior, stimulated. Moreover, whipping, chains, leather underwear, torture, mock execution, a writer explained in 1969, represented, quote, a kind of death substitute. And death was a topic on which Warhol himself had long been fixated, notably in his 1963 Death series. During his psychedelic period, Carol Dolph Gross remembered, quote, Warhol and Paul Morrissey sit in the back of the factory and encouraged people to take drugs so they could film the effect of it. chronic abuse of methamphetamine can result in psychosis and cardiovascular damage. Both with the potential for death. Before his fixation with the Freudian death drive, Warhol was a really skillful painter. Beyond his fixation with the Freudian death drive, Warhol was a really skillful painter, creating beautiful art and selling them at high price for Kusama. Warhol was not going to change the governing structure of the society. By contrast, at the height of the 60s political dissent, Kusama was accepted by New York's counterculture milieu as one of their own. When she and the love candidate for the 1969 mayoral race, Luis Abolafia, kicked off his campaign at the Sheep's Meadow Central Park, the Village Voice reported 100,000 to 125,000 people attended at the peak of the festival on account of the social change that began taking place with President Nixon's Law and Order campaign of 1968. However, by the end of 69, the utopian aspiration of these youth began to vanish. By 1971, at the onset of neoliberalism, the government concluded that, quote, biennial participation has been used to manipulate certain artists into commercial prominence, unquote, and fully endorsed that eventuality, instigated, quote, a return to reliance on private efforts and funding with regard to international art exhibition, unquote. Hence, economics, largely through Castelli's brilliant marketing scheme, helped shape 1960s American art, but it was profoundly shaped as well by the proto-feminist outlaws like Kusama. The trajectories of the 60s US art can be fully grasped only when such complexities are brought to light through transnational and feminist analysis. So, thank you very much. Yes.
Do we know what Warhol thought of Kusama?
Well, I heard from the people who were active during this time that they all hated Kusama because she was very difficult, but I'm not quite sure what Warhol actually thought of her. But I know that in 1962, when they were showing in the same gallery, they were sitting in front of the gallerist, Richard Bellamy, and they were saying that I'm only going to show with the stars, and that implied, you know, both artists thought that they are not the stars, that, you know, they are disqualified to be in the exhibition with them. Yeah, is that clear? And it's quite amazing that the psychedelic light shows which she was creating was called, the venue was called Electric Circus, and it was actually the dome in another guise. That dome was like maybe like a month and a half venture, and then after that, I think Kusama was going after Warhol and making sure that it's sort of like cleaning what was happening with her more like erotic performances.
I have two questions. The first one is, how was Kusama received in Japan around this time?
Okay.
And then the second question is,
good question.
What's her relationship with the other female artists at the time?
Okay. Excellent questions. Thank you so much. During this time, while she was in New York, she was always sending all these, press materials and so on to the art critics in Japan, but they didn't really take her seriously because she was a woman. And thus, she didn't really have an opportunity to show in Japan, even though she was trying very hard. And I know that because it appears in her calendar diary. In New York, she remembers Eva Hess, who was living in the same complex of the building which she was living between 1961 and 64, was visiting her, and she was very, I think she liked Hesse, and she remembered when I interviewed her that she went to see Hesse when Hesse had cancer, and Kusama remembers that when Hesse was like touching her hair, the hair was just coming out because of the cancer treatment. So I would think she was very nice to female artists, but I heard like many male artists didn't really like her. But at the same time, I think she appealed to some like influential people. So some people like who had more power, such as Lawrence Alloway, who was a champion of pop art. I think she was very passionately approaching to him. Yes.
What about Yoko Ono?
They thought New York was too small for two women, two great women artists, and they are so scary. Yes. Any other questions? Yes.
So it sounds like she's very meticulous in detailing sort of her life.
Yes.
That really helps in, I guess, research.
Right.
Into her. Is that unique for artists of the 60s? It sounds like art critics usually are the ones who are cataloging historically artists. She's sort of self-cataloging her life.
Yes, she was self-cataloging and she knew that there was no witness for her career, so she really recorded a lot, and she didn't really have a lot of money during this like early 60s, but she was once in a month or so I saw like the payment for the photographers, and she was having photo sessions all the time. So this was someone who was very unusual. But I did see her original box where she brought her archival materials back from New York to Japan. It's really so messy that she put everything in the box and then sealed it and brought it back to Japan. So it's quite an work of, I think, Alexandra Monroe and Reiko Tomy, who worked on the her first U.S. exhibition in 1989, that they really like reorganized those very messy materials. Yes. Any other? Yes.
Were there any other Asian artists, female artists at the time during the 60s or 70s around when she was here, or did they come later?
Yes, I think there were quite a few. There's Momie. She started exhibiting at the corporate gallery because there was this Japanese artist. The name, I'm not quite sure, but I just found like her archival papers at the Smithsonian, so I want to go and see it. I think her first name was Momie, and I've seen in Kusama's archives that she had been sort of like pouring attention on this woman, and after she came to New York, like she started showing at that the same gallery. So I would think she was very aware. Also, there is Rakuko Naito, who is getting more attention just recently. She came here in 1958 with her husband, Tadaaki Kuwayama. Of course, Shigeko Kubota and some Fluxus women came. And it's very interesting that all these Japanese women who came to New York were quite liberated in here, and they became very, very radical artists. So that's very interesting. And Midori Yoshimoto wrote like five performance-based artists in New York, and they were all from this period. So if you are interested, I recommend you to read this book. It's very nice. Yes, Anthony.
How did you begin to concentrate only on the 60s period?
Yes, that's a really interesting question. Actually, I wanted to work on something different for my dissertation. I was very interested in Middle Eastern issue, and I was going to work on the artist whose name is Mona Hatun. But I didn't like the fact that she was ordering all her sculptures to the factories, and I wanted to have someone who was creating work with their hands. So that's how I discovered Kusama. So it's the artist who came first, and then the period came a little bit later. But it was a very interesting period because a lot of people thought, I think, the culture until that point was bankrupt because of what had happened, like atomic bombing and the Holocaust. So there were the concept of infinity, which I discuss in my book a little bit, it's very much about building something outside of what used to be there. And the artists went into new materials and new media and new expression. So everything was very much changing. And unlike American artists, the European artists were more positively thinking that they wanted to change or like build the world after the war. So there was a very strong utopianism which was in Europe, and also like people who were surrounding Kusama. And even though she was in New York, I think she really could connect with European artists because of the similar experience they come out of. Yes?
Did Kusama welcome your research, or did you have to convince her to?
I actually did a presentation on this, but initially when I wrote my first essay, which she had commissioned me to write it. And that was for Boyman's Museum exhibition in 2007. After she read my manuscript, she said, "This is like exposing my asshole to the public." But she gave me a permission. But after this incident, her dealer started calling her at the hospital room, and then I think he did some threatening to her, and after that my relationship with Kusama sort of like deteriorated. So I think like art dealing is something which really like also determines like, you know, interpretation of the artist. And now I think again people tend to think her in terms of like her mental illness. She does have like a condition, but it's not like being mad or crazy, that she has anxiety neurosis, that when she is made very anxious, I think she cannot stop thinking about one or two things. And there's an interesting story that I discovered through analyzing her diary, that she's a very suspicious person. And while she was getting like psycho analyst, she was having about three people at once. And then juxtaposing different analyses and then trying to see which one might be her case. So it's very interesting what she does. And one of her doctor was Japanese, so she could also hear about more like detailed analysis. But then, going back to the sexuality issue, which someone had asked, I'm not quite sure she was a very straight woman, because in the late 60s, she was very much like supporting, homosexual, like male and female people. And then one of the reasons why she was hosting these light performance and naked happenings is that she wanted people to really explore their real true sexuality. So in that sense, I think she was very advanced at the time. Yes. Any other questions? Yes.
Sorry.
No.
What were the political and cultural forces in Japan, in post-war Japan, that propelled her to come to New York?
Well, I think for women, it was very difficult, and especially someone like her who comes from very proper bourgeois family. I have interviewed her brother, and he is only about facade, that, you know, he would say how like proper their family was, and I don't think she liked to, I mean, she could survive in such environment, because I think there was no freedom, and the family sort of like disowned her, so they didn't have any her artwork, and she's very stingy that she doesn't want to give artwork to her family too. So there is like a conflict, and I wasn't supposed to be interviewing this brother, but she was reaching to an old age, and now she's no longer with us. So his son wanted me to interview him, and it was very interesting to see like this juxtaposition. He told me that their father was sending Kusama ichimanen, it's like $100 bill in the letter from Japan to New York every month, while he was working. His salary in Japanese yen was like juen, which is about $10 or so. So he was very generous. And even at this, like, you know, very terminal stage of his life. Thank you very much for coming.